The limitations of the Dalai Lama and Tibetan Buddhism.
What the Dalai Lama calls enlightenment is realizing that we originally have no intrinsic nature and only exist as names. To him, enlightenment is realizing we have no essence. Instead of calling empty awareness as Buddha nature, what he means by Buddha nature is just emptiness itself or emptiness without intrinsic nature. He's talking about something completely different.
The Dalai Lama, his character is great and everything, but the most unfortunate part about his holiness is that since the Gelug school he belongs to follows Madhyamaka logic, which is thoroughly a scripture-based system, his teachings about enlightenment are a mess. In Tibet, they study Madhyamaka logic for 20 years to master the exoteric teachings, the teachings available to everyone. Then, they say they study the esoteric teachings for the rest of their lives. But even if they study the esoteric teachings, there are so many problems with Madhyamaka in the first place. The Madhyamaka school of thought are teachings that thoroughly deny the existence of an absolute world and only accept the relative world. In other words, they are the school that waged everything on the denial of the true self. Therefore, even within Tibet, it conflicts with schools like Nyingma and Kagyu which accept the true self. On the Korean wiki and other sites, people wrote that it doesn't conflict. It's all nonsense. Since they can't not respect the teachings of the Madhyamaka school, they fit the descriptions of the Nyingma and Kagyu schools to align with the Madhyamaka school. But the Gelug school of Madhyamaka logic makes different claims than the Nyingma and Kagyu schools. Even the Dalai Lama, he talks about the theory of the Nyingma school and theory of the true self, including concepts like empty awareness, absolute realm, unstained luminous mind, pure consciousness, and Rigpa. But the Madhyamaka school denies the idea that the entire universe came from that spot.
The entire universe came from that true self spot? This is non-Buddhist.
So even though this theory doesn't align with the Madhyamaka school, since the Dalai Lama can't call the Nyingma and Kagyu schools non-Buddhist, he makes a compromise and says,
these can be seen as special versions of the Madhyamaka logic.
If that was the case, then Hinduism is also a special version. It's nonsense. It's all just nonsense. Since the Tibetan schools need to achieve harmony within themselves, they're trying to justify themselves in any way possible. However, their core is fundamentally different. Madhyamaka will absolutely not accept that the universe is an appearance of my consciousness, the function of my consciousness. And so the way Madhyamaka scriptures explain this is very abstruse. If something like this appears in the scriptures, they explain it in an abstruse way. How do they explain it? I coined the terms, universe merely concepts, or universe merely names. Strictly following Madhyamaka thought, universe merely names is more apt. The universe merely exists as names. Or, names are all that exists. Then does that mean this phone doesn't exist? No. It means that this phone exists as a phone, because we place the name, phone, on these materials that are merely combinations of dependent-arising five aggregates. Then what's the key emphasis? The name. The concept. The universe is merely names. The universe is merely concepts. This is the Madhyamaka logic. The universe is merely names. During the process of the universe impermanently dependent arising, we place a fixed name on this phone to make it seem like a permanent existence exists. This delusion is what makes us fall into ignorance. In other words, the reason we fall into ignorance is that we mistakenly think an actual permanent substance exists that correlates one-to-one to the fixed names, instead of knowing that the universe is merely names. When we say, phone, doesn't this mean we're assuming a permanent, non-ceasing, fixed, unchanging phone exists? Taking this assumption to be real is ignorance. The concept of ignorance in the Madhyamaka sense is if you mistakenly assume an independent, fixed, non-changing substance called a phone exists, instead of understanding the phone as existing within dependent origination. If this exists, that exists. So we fall into ignorance because we placed a name there. Therefore, the universe is merely names. The key is that it's merely names. The name is phone, but in reality, the phone doesn't exist. Where could a fixed, non-changing phone exist? If you reason about it, this phone can be entirely disassembled. Then it's merely a combination of its parts within the principle of dependent origination where this part exists because that part exists. Furthermore, only because this combination of the five aggregates exists, could we give it a name. Hence, everything is impermanently dependent arising, and within this system, there is nothing that has an independent existence called a phone. So if you say that an independent thing exists, that's ignorance. The reality is impermanence, but not simply just impermanence, but impermanence due to dependent origination. It's all functioning under the laws of causality. After realizing this, then in a phenomenal sense this phone is impermanent, in a deeper sense it's dependent arising, and in the ultimate sense, it is without independent intrinsic nature or substance, which is called emptiness. Since this is the Madhyamaka logic, if you follow their logic, you don't need an absolute world. They take the concept of emptiness, which is a truth of absolute nature, and bring it down to the relative world to say that this phone is empty because it is without an independent intrinsic nature or a fixed substance. In summary, the phone exists in a phenomenal sense. It exists as an impermanent form. However, essentially it doesn't exist. Why does it not exist? I can make calls with it and stuff, right? But there is no fixed thing called a phone. Therefore, it is empty. Then what do we call this? The universe is merely names. The universe is merely concepts. The reality is that there is no such permanent substance. Now, if we go to the exact corresponding Yogacara school, consciousness-only school, ignorance is defined as thinking that this phone exists independently outside of my consciousness. This is called parikalpita svabhava. It's a slightly different feeling, isn't it? The phone has no independent existence. Why? Because it's the function of my consciousness. This is the key. The premise of Yogacara is already different. Can you see that it's different? There was no need for an absolute world in the previous Madhyamaka logic. Their logic is that everything in the relative world is in a state of flux, changing according to the laws of causality, and there is nothing eternal. In Yogacara, there is already an absolute world, the world of tatata, suchness. Since this phone is created when the world of tatata expands consciousness into the 8th, 7th, 6th, and 5th consciousnesses, thinking that this phone exists separate from my consciousness is ignorance. This ignorance is called parikalpita svabhava, being attached to conceptually constructing that something independent exists apart from me. Next, realizing that nothing independently exists and everything is the function of my consciousness is called paratantra svabhava. This thing exists because my mind exists. It exists due to dependent origination. So for a moment, the two sides can seem similar. Madhyamaka says, the essence was dependent origination, and Yogacara also says, the essence was dependent origination. But what's the difference? What Madhyamaka means is, a mere name was placed during the process of dependent origination. But what Yogacara means is, everything is the function of my consciousness. Thus, if we go to the conclusion, the ultimate final form, we arrive at Parinisbana Svabhava. What is Parinisbana Svabhava? The world of tatata, suchness, exists. A world that is whole and real exists. To summarize, these are the trisvabhava, or three nature of things, from a consciousness-only perspective. Firstly, parikalpita svabhava. We fall into ignorance by thinking that a thing independently exists without me. Secondly, paratantra svabhava. In actuality, all things are the function of my consciousness and the work of causality. Thirdly, parinisbana svabhava. In the ultimate sense, there is only tatata, suchness, and everything unfolded from this tatata. This Yogacara thought is not one bit different from Nyingma or Kagyu thought. But Madhyamaka denies this theory and instead asserts that this phone is empty in a forced manner. Even though both sides say, I've realized emptiness, the Nyingma school, the followers of the teachings of Paramasambhava, realize the true emptiness of empty awareness. They realize the place of awareness amidst emptiness. On the other hand, the emptiness that the Dalai Lama has realized is that there really is no intrinsic nature. He realizes this by intensely meditating on the idea that there is no intrinsic nature with a focused mind. So even though they both emphasize the simultaneous cultivation of samadhi and prajna, they come to different conclusions about enlightenment. When meditating intensely with a focused mind, thinking that even this meditating mind has no substance and only appears under the laws of dependent origination is what Madhyamaka means by enlightenment. On the other hand, what enlightenment means to Yogacara or Nyingma, Mahayana schools like Huayan, or schools that emphasize the Lotus Sutra like Tiantai, is the realization of the ultimate tatata mind. While these schools realize the place of awareness amidst emptiness called empty awareness, the Madhyamaka school really just realizes emptiness itself. They realize empty nature, sunyata. Because of this difference, no matter how much the Dalai Lama travels the world to spread his teachings, in the end, all he talks about is
the relative world is impermanent. it is dependent arising. Therefore, we must help each other. We must be compassionate.
He only explains it this way. He is unable to teach directly, like Nyingma, Kagyu, or Zen Buddhism, about how the entire universe came from empty awareness, the intrinsically enlightened true mind, the pure luminous mind, the mind of primordial energy, original mind, the empty but luminous unborn wisdom. He is unable to directly say that this spot is bodhicitta and how this spot is the root of our conscience and six paramita. So what the Dalai Lama calls enlightenment is realizing that we originally have no intrinsic nature and only exist as names, I'm a human, or, I'm me, exists. To him, realizing that we have no essence is enlightenment. What he calls nishvabhava, no intrinsic nature, is how nothing permanent exists, which is also what he calls sunyata. The realization of this is what he calls enlightenment. Since you can become the Buddha if you realize this, he also calls it Buddha nature. Instead of calling empty awareness as Buddha nature, what he means by Buddha nature is just emptiness itself or emptiness without intrinsic nature. He's talking about something completely different. In many of his books and lectures, the Dalai Lama even went as far as to use his theory to explain Zen Buddhism by saying,
I suspect what Zen Buddhism means by Buddha nature isn't a permanent, non-ceasing mind, but rather no intrinsic nature.
In this case, then we all become screwed. Although I really respect the character of the Dalai Lama, because he didn't know enlightenment, even after lecturing and preaching for such a long time all across the world, he wasn't able to produce any actually enlightened persons. Any real bodhisattvas, bodhisattvas who are bursting with bodhicitta aren't being produced, because of the limitations of the Madhyamaka logic. Madhyamaka is a school that ultimately emphasizes theory. It's not like they don't meditate, but since theory comes first, since concepts precede experiences, ultimately they can't truly understand enlightenment. I wanted to say something along these lines. This is why when you listen to the contents of any of the Dalai Lama's lectures, the teachings about enlightenment are always missing. Actual self-evident understanding of absolute bodhicitta or the pure luminous mind is missing. It's not like he never mentions absolute bodhicitta, but to the Dalai Lama, absolute bodhicitta doesn't mean empty awareness. To him, the mind that's intuitively perceiving that, ah, there is no intrinsic nature in me or the universe, is absolute bodhicitta or prajna wisdom. He never precisely emphasizes the absolute awareness that actually transcends space and time. He views all forms of consciousness, whether it be the true self or the absolute awareness that transcends space and time, to be dependent arising and to be impermanent. This confusion arises when the Madhyamaka teachings that nothing exists that isn't impermanent clashes with these teachings of the absolute. So when you listen to the Dalai Lama's lectures, he speaks out of both sides of his mouth.
It says that the pure luminous mind of the Nyingma school, that mind of empty awareness, transcends space and time, has never been born, and is beyond the laws of causality. But nothing exists that's free from dependent arising. This is the Madhyamaka logic. But this doesn't mean Madhyamaka denies this side.
He says this and then just moves on. He always just glosses over this. He never directly distinguishes these two contradicting sides and explains how they head on collide. I couldn't find it in any of his lectures or his works. He always vaguely glosses over this. This is what I think the problem is. The problem is the Dalai Lama's Madhyamaka logic. The problem is the Gelug school that places Madhyamaka as the most supreme teaching. The problem is the fact that the Gelug school is leading Tibetan Buddhism. Although there must be various circumstances for that. Lastly, the fact that the Nyingma and Kagyu schools are unable to emphasize the pure true self, even though Paramasambhava himself called it true self, is truly unfortunate.